Avnash, so great to have you here. We're really honored. I mean, your book was one of the first I read in web analytics and digital marketing. Somehow you're part of building all of that. So it's a great pleasure to have you here. Thank you so much for being with us for the interview and for the RD Summit talk.
Yeah, no, I'm excited to be here. I'm amazed at how many people you managed to gather here.
Yeah.
So not just the sponsors, but thousands of people in there.
Yeah.
So congratulations to you as well.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much. So we want to cover a few things that you've mentioned there, and it would be great if you could highlight what are the main topics you covered
there.
What do you think it's important for a business to understand now regarding data and how they can use it to leverage their business?
Sure. So I my talk focused on artificial intelligence, and it's like a very big topic. So the things that I try to do today is get people to understand that what is the thing that is powering at the moment most of the advanced things that we are doing, all of us, and it's basically deep neural networks. And then how do you use deep neural networks to create a different kind of business? So I talked about three short stories, if you will. And the first story was about how do you create an AI army inside your company? Regardless of marketing, regardless of analytics and digital, I believe it is really important that every company have a cluster of employees who are very comfortable using machine learning, using deep neural networks, on top of all this amazing amount of data that you have about the company, ERP, CRM, HR, all these places where you have data. How do you use deep neural networks to find insights faster? The second piece was all about how do you move faster? How can you do in 5 months what normally takes you 5 years to do? How do you change velocity? And so I talked about the power of cloud platforms that are offered by Amazon, by Microsoft, by Google and other companies, because I truly believe that large-scale machine learning services that are in the cloud will transform the speed for every organization. And then the last cluster of stories, I gave five different examples about how we are applying at Google machine learning to analytics and to marketing, and how we're able to solve problems that are very hard for humans to solve. And I gave a number of Brazilian examples of companies that can use that for digital marketing and digital analytics. So those were like three big pieces. I call them learn, build, profit.
I want to talk about this last one because when people think about machine learning and artificial intelligence and things like that, they tend to think about robots and no feeling and no people at all. And you have an approach of saying those things as a way to get a better human experience, actually, to be human-centered marketing. So how do you connect those things? How you use data to create more value to people, actually?
Yeah, so actually, here's I gave this example in my talk today. I took this really, so first thing is, I focus on machine learning and deep neural networks as in software. Maybe one day this software will be inside robots, but that's not my area of expertise. Somebody else will talk about it. But I gave this really simple example of how a travel website and people come and engage with a travel website, everybody sees the same thing. Even if you visit it 20 times, you see the same thing. Whether you come from a Google AdWords click or you come from email marketing, same thing, it's so stupid. And I showed how you can use deep neural networks to understand every single human being who engages with you across all touch points, online, offline, phone channels, everywhere, so that you can create more meaningful experiences. So in the after version of the example, you could see the website said, "Welcome Sam." So he understands who it is. And then instead of giving them 50 things, it gave them the one of three things that is right for you at this moment. And so I showed the websites of Claro, one of the Brazilian telecom company, Extra, one of the Brazilian e-commerce company. They have these long, long pages. It's like walking somebody into a warehouse. Instead of saying, "Hello, Andre, I know who you are, what you want," and just give you exactly what you're looking for, sometimes even before you ask, which is magical. So that's like a really simple but good example of using data, understanding every human, and delivering happiness to the human and exchanging that for profit. That's the magical part. So it's just one of many examples of how we can use deep neural networks to create happy, relevant, and meaningful experiences for our customers.
That is great. One question I think you get a lot is there anything to be afraid of machine learning and artificial intelligence?
So, overall, I'm very optimistic about the outcomes from machine intelligence, deep learning. It's going to take away the things that we don't like doing. It's going to allow us to solve problems that are very hard for humans to solve. So I am overall very optimistic as I look out over the next few decades. There will be some areas in which, because we can automate something, there might be temporary challenges for us to work through. So the example in our conversation I gave yesterday is the largest job in the US is truck drivers, about 4.5 million truck drivers. It's hard to think that the most popular job is truck drivers, but it is. And we are looking 5 years from now where trucks will drive themselves. So yes, because of deep learning, because of automation, we may not need as many truck drivers. But the interesting thing is, who likes to drive trucks? Yeah? We can use the same human capital to do other productive things. That's why I think it is myopic to think that machine intelligence and deep learning is going to have massive job losses, humans will have nothing to do. I think we will have better things to do. And so far as we look in human history, whenever automation has come and done X or Y problem for human beings, we have figured out how to do new, more interesting, fun things with human beings. So that's what I believe.
That's great, that's great. And when we talk about metrics, it's another another theme. You're an expert. Many people are talking about the North Star metric, or the one metric you have to define your business. Do you believe in that concept? Do you think it makes sense? And usually, what metric do you think that can play this role?
Yeah. So I don't believe in like a God metric thing, because I think most businesses. CEO, let's just think about CEO, okay? If there's somebody who wants one metric, it's usually the CEO, because he or she does not have enough time. And you can't give them 50 reports. The CEO is very busy, right? So I do think that when it comes to digital especially, what I recommend is having 6 metrics. 2 metrics for acquisition, which is marketing, 2 metrics for behavior, and 2 metrics for outcomes. So when you give your CEO these 6 metrics, 2 each, it gives them a complete picture of the business. What are we doing to generate interest in our brand? That's 2 metrics, right? What are, it could be brand metrics, performance metrics, and then once people engage with our brand, what is their behavior? How many times do they engage with us? What are they doing? Are they happy, sad, et cetera, et cetera? So those are 2 behavior metrics. You can use it to improve your website, you can use it to improve your mobile apps, you can use it to improve your retail store experience, behavior, right? And the last one is outcomes. Most CEOs will say, just report revenue to me. And that's okay. It is a short-term metric, but I say, report revenue and report economic value that shows long-term impact of the company. Now, when you give those 6 metrics to a CEO, they have an end-to-end picture, and they know which of their direct reports to call and fire if they have this thing. If people really push me and say, no, only one, then I tell them that use economic value. Because for me, economic value...
You mean lifetime value?
Yeah, no, it's the combination of short-term revenue and long-term value that was created for the company. So it's a combination of the 2 things. And then for a senior leader in the company, it's a good balance.
Yeah.
Because they don't make short-term, narrow decisions, but also think about the long-term. But normally I say, cover acquisition, cover behavior, cover outcome, and you will create a smarter CEO.
One thing that is usually a pain for every marketer is that it's really hard to measure branding, right?
And yes,
and it becomes
that's right.
way more harder those days. It's easy to find performance metrics. I can see how many leads it generated
yes, yes.
or how is my website traffic or anything like that. But I can see how my branding is being viewed by my customers
right.
and something like that. So how do we do it? How
yes.
do we get out of this?
This is a great question. No, I believe we can bring the same discipline that we bring to performance marketing to brand marketing. I wrote a post on LinkedIn about 2 months ago about brand marketing and brand metrics. And most of the time what our clients, all these wonderful people, end up using is, they will say, help me measure brand awareness. So I run a lot of ads on TV. Are more people aware of RD station, right? And that's okay, it's a start. Or they will say, I want to measure reach. That's a brand metric. How many people, it's like the old school eyeballs. How many eyeballs did I get?
Yeah.
So I think that reach, impressions, brand awareness are very primitive metrics. If you have nothing, at least measure that.
Yeah.
What I like more are two important metrics. After your branding campaign, we measure for our clients likelihood to recommend. So all these people came to RD Summit.
NPS.
All these people came to RD Summit. They have a good experience. Are they aware of RD platform? Okay, fine, that's fine. How many will recommend your platform? How many people will recommend your brand? That's a much higher thing. If you tell him, like, I recommend this brand, he will take you much more seriously than him watching. So that's the first one. And the second one we watch over the long term is likelihood to buy. Not immediate conversion rate, but as a result of our advertising, as a result of our booth experience, as a result of our billboard, how likely is it that you will buy our product? And that's a brand metric. So I encourage brands to move to those two metrics, likelihood to recommend, likelihood to buy, because it shows that you are having a short-term and a long-term impact as a result of your brand. Of course, you have all your performance metric, you can have it. But if you're not measuring likelihood to buy and likelihood to recommend, then you really have no understanding if you're adding business value. I'll give you a simple example. For one of the companies, we measured the TV campaign. They spend about $40 million on television advertising.
That's a lot.
Okay, that's great. So we measure brand awareness. It's like, yay, drink champagne.
Yeah.
Then I said, for this company, we also have a survey that helps us measure attitudinal brand metrics. And we segmented it. Okay, so where is awareness going up? And we segmented by different type of people. And it turns out, when we merged these two pieces of data, that brand awareness has grown up. 80% of the increase in brand awareness is in the type of people who will never buy this company's product. So what's the point?
It's marketing based on the marketer, not in the customer, right?
So you realize what a stupid waste of money it was to spend $40 million on TV. But if you use brand awareness, yes, it's up. That's what I think. Mixing these two data sets allowed us to shift advertising to Hulu, shift it to YouTube, shift to other channels, because on those channels we found people who will be buying our products.
That is great. Avinash, you have wrote a few awesome books. You have a great blog. One piece of content that got really famous and it's really interesting is your See, Think, Do framework.
Yes.
I would like to talk to some people who are watching us right now. What is this framework and how we can use it in our companies?
Sure. I gave an example earlier in my keynote about how marketing to demographics, marketing to psychographics, who the person is, what their age is, what their gender is, if they have children or not, is a really poor way to do marketing. So one of the coolest things that we have, one of the coolest things that you can enable for your clients with your new RD platform is get an understanding of a human being's intention. And so I built a new framework called See, Think, Do, Care. And the framework uses intent in order to classify audiences. So it says people who are your largest addressable qualified audience, people with weak commercial intent, strong commercial intent, and your existing extra loyal customers. And it's a framework that allows you to change the way your business thinks about marketing, change the way your business thinks about metrics and analytics, and rather than using demographics and psychographics, data that was available in 1905, use data available in 2017 to completely transform the way they think about a business's digital presence by executing based on intent and not age, not on gender, not those kind of stereotypes.
That is great. Avinash, one last question.
Yes.
I'll repeat the same thing we were talking yesterday. Let's suppose I hire you to improve my results. Where would you start at? How would you diagnose it? How would you create your action plan? We have many agencies watching
us.
Yes, of course. We have many clients starting a new marketing campaign or process. So how do they start with it?
So especially if I'm working in an agency type relationship where I'm the agency and I've been hired by a client to do some work, I built a framework called the Digital Marketing Measurement Model. And it's a 5-step process. And the process allows you to identify what are the best metrics for a company and what are the best places to start to do measurement and optimization for a company. So in an ideal scenario, I will work with the client to define the digital marketing measurement model. Essentially, it's saying, let me, an outsider, not come and figure out by myself what's important to you. You help me understand, where are you spending most of your money? Where are you spending most of your time? Where are most people in your company investing their time? And use that to drive improvement. So very customer-centric approach. Sometimes we don't have that chance. Sometimes we don't have an ability to go through the digital marketing and measurement model. And so for me, if I'm going blind, that's what I say, I always start at the very end of the process. So my goal in every client engagement, whether I'm working inside a company or as a part of an agency, is to say, in 30 days, I will add more revenue to your company. I don't worry about marketing. I don't worry about clicks and landing pages and all that. My very first job is to figure out, what can I do with your checkout process and the cart process? Because if I can improve anything there at the very end of the cycle, then I can make more revenue for you. And even small changes I have made to the cart, the small changes I've made to the add to cart button, small changes I've made to the checkout process, go from 3 pages to 1 or 1 pages to 2, I can improve conversion rate in a couple of weeks. It's easy. So my first instinct is to measure abandonment rate, measure conversion rate, look at time lag and path length, and use those metrics to improve the outcomes that I can drive for my client. So this is my first step. Always make them money. If as an agency in 30 days you can't go and make money for your client, what the hell are you doing, right? 30 days. Then what I do as step two is I will skip to the very beginning of the process. So I normally will get the report for the top 10 landing pages, and then what is the bounce rate for the top 10 landing pages. That really helps me understand where are the most traffic coming and how can I reduce the bounce rate and get more people into the cycle.
I have an asset, but I'm not using the right way.
Exactly. Or you're spending money on advertising and bringing people who jump right away. Or you're spending time on email marketing and people leave right away. What's the point of that? So that second thing I will do is improve landing pages through A/B testing, through those kinds of, reduce bounce rate. And then step three is always to figure out how to improve product pages. And then step four, I will figure out how do I look at the place where the company is spending most amount on paid marketing and go improve that. So that's my 1, 2, 3 step, four step process. But you can notice that in every case, rather than putting myself first, I'm putting the company first. That's step one and step two. And with step three and four, I'm starting to worry about my clients' customers. And I think if you do that, then you will do very well for yourself. From day one, your client knows that you're interested in making them a lot of money. And that leads to a very good, long-term, productive relationship.
That is great. Avinash, it was so great to have you here. So inspiring. I hope we can have you here again for the next editions when that future becomes present and you can predict everything that is coming ahead of us. So thank you so much again. It was great.
Thank you for having me. And I set 3 goals for our audience in October 2018.
Let's see what they do. Yeah, we have to check it again, right?
Thank you, Andre. It was a pleasure.
Bye-bye. Thank you.